This unit contains information on why and how to conduct literature research. Literature research, as one of the most fundamental tasks in science, is a time-intensive but very necessary task. Hardly anybody is the first one to report on any issue you might encounter in your scientific studies, so don't try to reinvent the wheel. You conduct literature research to find out whether an approach to a problem is new, to find out if alternative perspectives or approaches have already been taken, to widen the scope of your problem at hand, to obtain more background information, or to obtain evidence for your or others' claims. There are many different types of scientific literature. For example, there are textbooks and monographs. They are mostly used for well-established theory, basics, and approved techniques. Then, there are scientific journal papers, which present completed research lines. You have full conference papers, which present state-of-the-art research, and are one of the most major publication types in computer science. There are also short conference papers too, which, together with workshop papers, are more focused on new ideas and ongoing research. Technical reports are used to report on new ideas and smaller contributions, and fit a similar niche to short and workshop papers. Conference and online tutorials provide access to basics and techniques, and popular science magazines can be used to easily stay up to date on research lines. And finally, there are all the other websites providing access to every other material beyond that. Your literature research should ideally be based on high-quality sources. This begs a question on how the quality of a publication can be estimated. First of all literature you use should be peer-reviewed. Fortunately, most books, journal, conference, and workshop papers undergo a peer review process. As a rule of thumb, there's an inherent order of sources you should attribute credibility to. Books are ranked higher than journals, which in turn are ranked higher than conference papers. Next are workshop papers, then technical reports. Following that, magazines, then websites, and finally, all other sources of scientific material. There are, of course, some exceptions to this list. For example, a paper published at a top conference would rank higher than the average journal article. But how do you know what is a top conference or an average journal? That's where conference and journal rankings can help. They provide an indication of credibility for conferences and journals. Most commonly, four ranks are distinguished. A+ or A*, a top tier of publications with high-quality research of high impact to the field. The A tier sits slightly below, followed by the B tier, which still includes trustworthy resources. Unranked journals and conferences might raise some suspicions. However, keep in mind that no ranking can achieve complete coverage. A reputable source of such rankings is the CORE portal. Another good indicator is the number of citations a paper has, as it roughly corresponds to the importance of a paper in its field or topic. However, recently published papers naturally tend to have lower citation counts. A good resource to obtain such citation counts is Google Scholar. Some journals also provide their own impact metrics, mostly derived from citation counts. Keep in mind that good and bad research can appear in all places. Often, the best thing is to read the sources and then decide for yourself. If you have found an interesting paper, the next step is to read it. But when reading papers, efficiency is key, given the vast amount of available information. Following its logical structure is a helpful way of getting a quick intuition about the content of a paper. Start with the abstract to judge if the paper fits the general topic you want to find out more about. Then, proceed to read the introduction and the conclusion to get a closer look at the idea and results of the paper. Looking at the figures and tables, if provided, can aid quickly comprehending the paper's main goals. After that, you can decide if it is worth your time to read the rest of the article. Also, read goal-driven. While reading, keep in mind the specific questions you want to have answered by this paper. After you finish reading a paper, it is a good strategy to have a closer look at its references, to find more literature that might be relevant to you. You can also search for papers that cited the one you just read. The more papers you read, the better you will get at identifying what other sources might be relevant to you. In most seminars taught by Webis, you will be provided with a reading list, which is compiled to give you a good starting point for your own reading. Getting access to papers you want to read can sometimes be tricky. Although many papers are available online, some might only be accessible from within the university network. A VPN tunnel helps if you're not physically at the university. If that still does not allow you to read the paper, you can try to email the authors and ask them for a copy. Most are happy to share their research. Important sources for paper full texts are Google Scholar and the DBLP. For books specifically, you can check your university's library, and some books might also be accessible via Google Books. It is very helpful to organize your literature. Making an effort to maintain notes and an overview will pay off once you compile more and more literature. Create a logical folder structure. This will help you to build your own view of the field. You can logically subdivide it into subtopics, but don't over-engineer it. Name your files consistently. This simplifies browsing and grepping. At Webis, we use the author year full title format. Organizing the meta information is as important as organizing the files themselves. Save all the bibliographical information needed when citing literature when you add new literature to your collection. You can use BibTeX to keep an organized collection of meta information.